Psalm 150 says this. Praise the Lord. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise Him with the harp and the lyre. Praise Him with the timbre and the dancing. Praise Him with the strings and the pipe. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals. Praise Him with the resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Let's praise Him.
seated.
I have the privilege this morning of introducing our speaker, and I'll get to it. But going to college here in Kansas, here at CCC, everyone, you guys hear about KU a lot, and KU basketball especially. So as part of it, I would watch a lot of games when I was in college, you know, back in the dorm with my buddies. And I remember watching them, that guy named Wayne Sibbin, who was an absolute monster on the floor. An absolute, absolute great player. So over those years, I got to watch him play, and not knowing we'd cross paths years later. And he's pretty upset with me right now, so I showed that video without his permission. I told him about 3 minutes before we showed it that we're gonna show a video on him. And because I know the type of guy Wayne is, I got to know him over the last 8 years, and if I would have asked him to show a video of himself, he would have made sure that I would not have done that. So I apologize, Wayne. But I showed that video because I just want you to, I want everybody to see what type of guy he is. And one of the biggest individually celebrated moments in his life, he made sure it wasn't about him. And that's not easy to do. That's not easy, especially nowadays. He made sure it was not about Wayne Sibbin, but he made sure he gave all the glory back to God. And I thought that was awesome. You know, I've seen a lot of things on Wayne playing basketball, and I've heard him speak several times, and I've got to know him as a friend, and but it always goes back to God, no matter how many accomplishments this guy has had. He's a guy that probably has an unmatched passion for KU basketball. Being around it, growing up here in Kansas, and being around KU basketball for the last, I don't know how many years. But knowing Wayne over the last several years, I know he's a greater passion to lead others to Christ and to God's team and to mentor and disciple others. So I want to introduce to you guys a guy that has encouraged me over the years, one of the most humble and selfless men I know. Let's give him a warm CC welcome to Wayne Sibbin.
You have to show the whole thing, you just get to the very end. I was like a root canal over there, just like I was in the dentist chair having to watch. I hadn't seen it since it went down, but I guess sometimes you just got a mic drop for Jesus, right? You know, and he's worth it. And it was kind of cool just being able to see that. 5 years ago, so now I can actually grow some facial hair. I'm like 2 or 3 gray hairs now. We've got 2 more kids than what we had in there, but it was a special moment, but this is the type of setting that I really enjoyed being in. It was so much fun being able to play on the Court Allen Fieldhouse to be able to experience that moment. Got a chance to visit this campus last year for a fundraiser, which was great, getting a chance to meet some of your alumni and some of your supporters and donors and things like that. But I love the college campus. My wife and I have been the campus missionaries for the last 7 years, but get me amongst the people, get me around the college folks. And I'm really excited to be able to be here sharing with you this morning. Real quick, I won't be here long, but just want to share with you guys something that has really changed the dynamic of my Christian faith. It's really added so much adventure, so much excitement to my walk with Christ. Has really been able, one of the key things, actually annihilated like spiritual boredom that oftentimes tries to hinder us from fully being able to walk in the joy of the Lord, but also it's something that I've seen continue to be a hurdle or a hindrance to young people in their walk with the Lord. And I want to share with you this morning about all of our life is sacred. Okay, all of our life is sacred. And so, as many of you maybe have experienced personally, or maybe you see out there in the world, that there is kind of a dualistic mindset that the world has, or maybe that we struggle with sometimes, in thinking that our life can be divided into 2 specific categories, okay? So one category we often think, okay, this is the sacred side, Okay, these are the things that please God. These are the things that are important. These are the things that are holy. These are the things that we see play out in the Bible. And these are the things that, okay, I have to make sure that I do on a daily basis to kind of get my God checklist done. You can think about your own list, but for me, that list looked like a church, prayer, Bible studies, devotional times, religious holidays. Man, these are the really kind of sacred, holy, important things, right? And then on the other side of that, okay, you have, you know, what you would consider is just the things that are secular. Things that you have to do kind of on a daily basis just to live life, just to kind of get by, the ordinary, the mundane things that, you know, probably don't have anything to do with the sacred side, but you just got to get them done, right? And so you got your job, your school, hobbies, different relationships that you have, your time that you spend, whether it's free time or work time, maybe even some talents that you get a chance to have and to enjoy. So oftentimes we kind of think of our lives in these two different categories. And sadly, I live my life in these two different kind of silos. And I often had my faith in that as well. And it was something that was really a hindrance to experiencing the full life in Christ that He had to offer me. So what I want you guys to understand here today, even as you think about what that looks like in your own life, is that they're all one thing. Okay? They're all one thing. All of our life is sacred, holy, pleasing, useful, and valuable to this amazing, awesome God that we get a chance to serve. And so I'm going to take a look at a quick scripture verse and how we know this, and then I'll tell you quick stories about how it's played out in my life. This is one of my favorite portion of scripture in all the Bible. Talks about the supremacy of Christ. You know, oftentimes, whether you're in athletics or you're in drama or you have a lot of money, whatever the case, we try to elevate ourselves, esteem ourselves, that being, you know, number one in the life and in the world. But man, when we get a chance to read and behold this scripture right here, it makes us feel really small, and it makes us to behold Christ in an extreme way. So yeah, we'll pick it up here. It says, speaking of Jesus, it says, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in Him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones, powers, rulers, or authorities, all things were created through Him and for Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He is the head of the body of the church. He is the beginning from the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything He might have supremacy. I love that. So that everything, Christ, might have the first place. It says, for God was pleased to have all of His fullness dwell in Him, and through Him to reconcile all things to Himself, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through His blood shed on the cross. I know there's a lot in there. Man, you can spend days unpacking that. But one of the things I really want to draw your attention to is that portion of scripture I have underlined there. That was my own emphasis to add for the sake of making sure you guys get a chance to connect with that. But Christ has reconciled all things unto Himself. There's not one part of your life, okay, there's not one area of influence that we get a chance to see on this earth that Christ is not reconciling back unto Himself because of His amazing sacrifice. And one of the things that I really struggled with when I first became a Christian, going back to this kind of dualistic mindset, is like, okay, God, I'm going to allow You to be the Lord and the King of these certain areas of my life. But you know what, these other parts of my life, these relationships, these dreams and aspirations that I have, these talents that I'm holding on to, I'm just going to hold on to these and I'm going to manage these myself. You know, you're really good at kind of handling the other things, the religious and the sacred stuff. You just take care of that. But I'm going to hold on to these things because I got some big plans, I got some big ideas, and I don't want you to mess those up. And I had an older gentleman that was speaking into my life at the time. He was able to recognize and kind of notice some different inconsistencies in my life. Again, this dualistic mindset that I had, he came and he sat down with me and he said, Wayne, listen. He's like, I kind of see this, you know, way you're living. I kind of see this struggle that you're having. He's like, I want you to understand that Jesus Christ is the King. Okay? He's the King. And either He's going to be King over your entire life, or He's not going to be King at all. And I was like, wow. Man, that's so true. And a king doesn't exercise rightful authority and power and influence over just a portion of his kingdom, over just a portion of his subjects, but man, over all of their life and all of their being. And I was making a mistake in not allowing God to come in to be king over every single part of my life, both in that which seemed sacred and that would seem secular. You know, one of the secular things that a lot of people think about, obviously, I have a basketball background, and that was one of the things that I was trying to hold back from God. Became a Christian July 12, 2003, going into my junior year, and prior to that, the game of basketball was solely about me. I would have never been able to say those kind of things we saw in that video, not even close. It was all about attention for me. It was all about achieving dreams. It was all about getting to the NBA, and I would step on or do anything to anyone just to get those meters. And so when I became a Christian, it was very evident to me, no one had to tell me, that I could no longer play and live and think the way that I had in the past. And sadly, I had no idea how to play basketball any other way. And to be honest, like when I became a Christian, like the first couple months, my basketball game was trash. Like I was no good. And Coach Self told me that when he got there. He's like, hey, I thought you were this and that, man. You're not any good. Like, where is this guy that I heard about? And so I was really wrestling with, man, the best thing that I can do with my life right now is to quit basketball, to drop out of school, and to go to some third world country and to become a missionary. Now, by no means am I diminishing that type of call in anyone's life. And that's valuable, that's important, and those are definitely needed. But I wasn't thinking of basketball or this gifting that I had in right away. And so I had that conversation with God on the way to our second exhibition game of the season. At 19th and Iowa, it was intercepted. I said, God, if you don't show me a different way to play this game, I'm done, I'm quitting, I'm gone. Because I saw basketball just as a game, not as something that was sacred to God. By the time that I drove from that intersection all the way to the park garage, the Allen Fieldhouse, I heard the Lord speak and he said, worship me. I want you to worship me. I'm like, wait a minute, what? Come on, worship you? Like, it's just basketball. Like, there's no choirs or hymnals in Allen Fieldhouse. If anything, these tens of thousands of people are worshiping me for what I do. I'm not going to worship you in these moments. He said, I want you to worship. I want you to posture your heart. I want you to worship about how hard you play, by how good of a teammate you are, by how selfish you are, by how you respond to adversity, by how you work, all these different things. Wow. Okay. I'll give that a try. And I tell you what, when that became the posture of my heart, something that seemed like a small little hobby turned into this incredible encounter with God every time I was on the court. Not just in games, but I'm talking about when I was in practice, on the line, running, treatment, coming through injuries. I mean, even the most difficult and mundane moments of this so-called hobby, man, I was able to encounter God in those places. And little did I know that one day it would escalate to being able to be this incredible witness for God on that platform. And by no means would that have been able to happen if I just merely saw basketball as just some kind of secular hobby that's not important to God. That's my story. What does it look like for you guys? As you think about these different things that you have access to, is it your time? Is it a talent that you have? Is it maybe a relationship that you thought was expendable, but maybe God wants you to use you to do some great things in it through that? Is it a sphere of influence that you have? Man, is it an errand or something mundane that you have to do on a regular basis that seems like it has no bearing to the world around you? You just have to get it done. But I'm here to tell you that, man, God wants to reconcile that thing unto himself. He wants to use it in an incredible way. I remember even experiencing that as a student. School to me was just a bare minimum. It was a necessary evil to play basketball. Okay? Do you want to play basketball? You got to be eligible. And so I did the bare minimum. But it was incredible how God challenged me in that. Hey, you're following me with all your heart. Man, you're pursuing basketball with all your heart. But what about this other area in your life? What about school? My God, it's just school. You know, I'm going to play basketball once I'm done in college anyways. What do I need this for? Hey, who do you think is the creator and the perfecter of every single academic discipline that you'll ever see? That's the Lord God. And he spoke that to me, and I find myself encountering him in these classrooms. Sociology was like, wow, God, you created people groups. You care about culture and diversity and languages and yeah, the world. It's all yours. But what happens, man, my heart gets engaged in this incredible level and I become a sociology major. End up loving it. Something that was boring and mundane and seeming like a necessary evil became something that I was passionate about because God helped me to see it, not just as a necessary evil, not just as something that was secular, but something that was sacred and holy to Him. He reconciled all things unto Himself. Okay? Enough about my life. Let's take a look at a Bible example. And take a look at the story of David and Goliath. Now, before you kind of check out on this and, you know, think of, hey, this is just Sunday school, kids' church, you know, popsicle stick characters, like, this dynamic, this kingdom dynamic is found woven within this story. Okay? So don't check out on me just yet because you're familiar with the story. But it's so cool to see how God, in this story, used something seemingly unimportant to get David to that place to be able to experience an incredible victory. All right? Because David, he didn't go to that battle looking for a fight. Okay? He was not looking for a fight. All right? So let's check and see what the word has to say. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 17. Picking up with the story, I'm sure you guys know where we're at. Samuel looks David as king after his family overlooks him. He's not king yet. He's serving Saul. He's the least in his family. He's a shepherd boy. He's overlooked. He's underappreciated. He's undervalued. But yet God is doing something in his life. And that's such a tender moment to think about because I know a lot of us can feel like that. Man, no one recognizes me. No one sees what I have to offer this world. Man, no one appreciates my talents and abilities. Man, here David is in this very same place. But yet, we know that his life didn't stay in that place, but he finished in an incredible way. So here, verse 17 says, "Now Jesse said to his son David, take this ephah of roasted grain and his 10 loaves of bread to your brothers and hurry them to the camp. Take along these 10 cheeses to the commanders of their unit. See how your brothers are doing. Bring back some assurance from them. They're with Saul and all the men in Israel in the valley of Elah, fighting against the Philistines. Early in the morning, David left the flock in the care of the shepherd, loaded up and set out as Jesse directed." Okay, I know it might seem like an abstract scripture verse. Hey, where is the excitement? The drama comes after it. But think about this. David got to that place. He got to the battlefield. He got to this opportunity where he was able to do some extraordinary things for God by running a simple errand. Okay, think about that. A basic, simple errand. Hey, son, go run this errand for me. Come back, bring a word. And we know there was so much more than just an errand. Why? How did that even take place? Because God met him there. Even that simple, basic, seemingly meaningless errand became holy and used for God in an incredible way. So think about these different mundane, boring, ordinary tasks that you feel like you're burdened with. Will you approach them with your eyes and your heart open and your faith ignited, seeing that God might use you to do something more than just run an errand? I love how it talks about David went and dropped the goods off. He went down to check on his brothers. And as he was checking on his brothers, man, he heard the taunts of Goliath. That was caught his attention. If it was about, okay, hey, David, I'm going to check my faith at the door. I'm going to leave it back here with my father Samuel. I'm going to run this errand, and I'll pick it back when I come up. Those taunts from that giant never would have struck his heart. Never would have been saying, who's this uncircumcised Philistine taunting the armies of the living God? Who is this? That phrase never would have been able to be uttered out of his mouth had he not brought his faith with him. Had he not seen that moment as sacred. He never would have been prepared to go on and to take and face that giant had in those small, ordinary, mundane moments, watching his father's sheep out in the pasture, no one looking around, and he's sitting there honing and sharpening his skills. Defeating a lion, defeating a bear, sharpening his skills with the sling. I've got a little boy, like, young boys, listen, they throw rocks at things all the time, especially when they get bored. I can imagine David just out there by himself, practicing over and over and over again. Man, what seemed like an ordinary, mundane, boring time watching his father shoot became a time of intense preparation. So that when he found himself in this opportunity to take a stand for God, he was ready. He was ready. So I just want to encourage you and challenge you as you're thinking about your own life. Think of it, all of your life is sacred. All of your life is holy and valuable and useful to God. Why? Because of the blood of Christ. As we get a chance to just behold and think about it, its power has the ability to reconcile not just the religious things in your life, not just Christian activity, not just religious holidays, but it has the power to reconcile every single part of your life to God. And when you live that way, this faith becomes an awesome adventure. It's no longer boring. It's no longer just a task. It's no longer just a family tradition to uphold. But you actually get a chance to partner with the living God and bring heaven to earth. And that's one of the things that I'm really passionate about, because it's added so much joy and excitement and adventure to my faith. And I want to see that thing restored in this generation. And so, lastly, as we close here, seeing all of your life is sacred to God, empowers you beyond just the satisfaction of being saved. Okay, that's a great satisfaction, great joy in knowing that you are righteous before God because you put your faith in Jesus Christ. But I hope that you would know there is so much more to experience than just that. There's so much more to partake and to participate in with God than just being saved. Man, when we get a chance to move into the significance of being seen holy and useful to God, being a part of what He's doing on earth. And that portion of the Lord's Prayer, man, it strikes all of our heart, on earth as it is in heaven. And we get a chance to get God's confidence when we do that. Only if we see with the lens of all of our life as being sacred, holy God. The power of the cross, the power of the blood of Jesus, reconciling all things back unto Himself. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for life and life abundantly. Lord, that comes through your Son, Christ. Lord, we thank you that His life laid down is reconciling and restoring all of our life back into you. God, help us not to see certain areas of our life as more holy and more sacred than others. God, we are so grateful that you can use it all, that it's meaningful to you. Lord, that you want us to use it to do great, mighty things for your name's sake. Lord, help us see all of our life as sacred. Help us to not overlook the ordinary, mundane things that you don't have a part of. God, you're involved in every single part of our life. Help us to live. Help us go on an adventure. Help us to love you in every way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, real quick, one more announcement. I'm headed back to Lawrence to do campus ministry. I want to continue to be a resource for you guys if I can, by any means. Tommy's got my information. You can hit me up on social media or whatever. But I want to let you guys know of an awesome opportunity that the ministry that I serve at, Call to Greatness, is offering college students. This summer is called our Summer Intensive. Okay, it's May 22nd to 28th. And this is an incredible time to gather with other young Christian leaders to be developed in this area and see how different parts of your life can be leveraged for the kingdom of God to be influenced on your campus, in your community, and in the culture around it. We've got students from all over the country that are coming in to participate in this. We're staying in dorms there. We're doing teaching lessons and workshops during the day. Then we'll get out in the evening, do some activities, put into practice what we've just learned. Also have fun while we're doing that. We have some incredible speakers coming. Darrell Miller, who is a world-renowned worldview expert, and he's going to be coming and sharing. A good friend of mine, Sterling Brown, who is one of the keynote speakers for Growing Leaders, which is the Tim Elmore Ministry in Atlanta, Georgia. He's going to be there. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be extremely valuable if you desire to impact your campuses, your cities, and your cultures for the kingdom of God. So I want to invite you guys to that. Myself and my friend Henry will be out there in the back. We have a table set up if you guys want to come grab some more information about it. It's only $125 that covers your housing, all the materials, it covers lunches. If finances are an issue, we would love to help you out with that. If you're an athlete and you're going to be coming, we've got a lot of athletes going to be coming. We'll be training while we're there. Okay, so we'll be doing strength and conditioning training while we're there. Basketball players, I'll be working with the basketball players. If we're going to be any other type athletes, we'll arrange for some coaches to be there to help train you. But we've got an incredible opportunity that we want to extend and invite you guys to help you have a better grid, that all of your life is sacred, but to see that used to be an influence for the kingdom of God. So thank you guys for joining us. Come check us out at the table. We'll be hanging out here for lunch afterwards. I hope to get a chance to meet some of you guys. So bless you guys. Thank you for the opportunity. And I'll pass it back over to the leadership here.
Same way we started. Listen to Psalm 150 if we just switch up a few of these words. It says, praise the Lord. Praise the God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the mighty heavens. Praise him in his acts of power for his surpassing greatness. Forget this. Praise him with your basketball. Praise him in the dorm room. Praise him with your job. Praise him with your classes. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let's go from here praising him. You guys are